Before we actually start discussing both of these methods, let's now go to ETABS and see how we can actually make the pushover load case and how we can visualize our results. So I'll skip this presentation now and show you an example model and the pushover case and the results also. So here I have a computer model in ETABS 17, and it is a non-linear computer model of an RC multi-story building. So it has a moment resisting frame and shear walls also, and I actually have deliberately make it gray color or black and white because I want to show you different hinge results or non-linearity in form of different color coding. So I can just make its color like this. It is a non-linear computer model, and you can see that if I go to define section properties and frame wall hinge, frame wall non-linear hinges, you can see that if I click on show generated properties, so there is a whole detailed list of non-linear hinges which are assigned in this model. Yes, this one. So you can see, for example, if this is B1H1, if I just modify this and then modify show hinge property, so you can see that this is a moment rotation hinge type, moment M3 hinge, which is having the moment on Y axis and rotation on X axis with some acceptance criteria. This is assigned to a certain beam B1. So similarly, if I go to some column hinge, if I go down maybe here, modify show hinge, I can see that this is the fiber PM2 M3 type hinge. So the columns are modeled using fiber hinges. So if I can go to define show fibers, here you can see that this is the column fiber, column cross section, and all of these are, this is the list of all column fibers which are assigned to this column. So the columns are modeled using fiber hinges, fiber PM2 M3, and beams are modeled using M3 concentrated plastic hinges. The hinge length which I used for column fibers is equal to the depth of those columns. You can set some hinge length also when you are going to assign the fibers. Similarly, I have shear walls, so there are shear wall hinges also. Shear walls are also modeled using fiber modeling approach. So this is, for example, one particular shear wall leg, the fiber hinge assigned to that particular leg, and you can see that these are all concrete and steel fibers in one particular leg of that shear wall. So this is the list of those fibers. So the point is that this is a non-linear computer model in which the beams are modeled using concentrated moment plastic hinges, the columns are modeled using fiber PM2 M3 fiber hinges, and shear walls are also modeled using fiber hinges. For fiber, concrete and steel fibers, I have assigned a non-linear material model to define the behavior of concrete and steel fibers. For concrete fibers, I can go to define materials, modify show material and non-linear material data, and I can click on show stress strain plot. So this is the stress strain curve which is assigned to my concrete fibers, and the acceptance criteria IO, LS and CP is also shown here. So this behavior is assigned to all the concrete fibers in my model. Similarly, the steel fibers I can show here, modify show material and then nonlinear material data, show stress strain plot. So this is the material model which I assigned to my steel fibers. So IO, LS and CP, you can see here that I have set IO equal to the yield point, LS beyond yield point and then CP significantly beyond yield point. So once we are clear with what nonlinear modeling approach is used in this constructing this computer model, we can now run its pushover analysis. So for that, since I want to push this building in the first mode shape pattern, so I should first know that what is the which direction is the first mode direction. So let's say that first I run the modal analysis, and the results of modal analysis can be used to identify that if I want to push it in first mode, which is the first mode? Is it x direction or y direction? So let me just open its version which is run already to show you the results of modal analysis, and then using that information we will be making the pushover load case, because that information will be used that which mode we want to push in. So let's say that we want to run the analysis in x direction of the building. So the first mode in x direction needs to be identified first, that which mode is the first mode in x direction. Maybe it is the first mode, maybe it is the second mode according to software numbering, because first mode may be in y direction and second mode may be in x direction. So I already have run this model. So let me see the modal analysis results first, and then we can make the load case for pushover analysis. So let me visualize the modal animations, or maybe first see the modal analysis table results. So this model is already run, so I can click on display and show tables, and in the analysis results, modal results, I can click on maybe modal participating mass ratios and modal periods and frequencies, and then I can see which mode is my first mode in x direction. See, the mode number 1 is having a time period of 1.181 second, and it is having the mass participation in x direction, which is 76%. So the highest mass participation in x direction is from mode 1. So actually my mode 1 is the first mode in x direction. Similarly, you can see here that my mode 3 is the first mode in y direction. The second mode is actually torsional mode. So this can be confirmed also. Let me just cancel this table and plot this first mode shape. So go to the deformed shape, and then in mode I can just select the first mode and apply, and then I can click maybe OK. I can click on this start animation, and it will animate the first mode for me. So this will confirm whether the first mode in x direction is the mode number 1 according to software numbering. So I think I should give the scaling factor as automatic and not some manual factor for plotting the mode shape. Yes. So I can click on start animation now and see how the building is having its first mode shape. So yes, it is the fundamental translational mode in x direction. So which means that if I want to perform pushover analysis in x direction of the building, and if I want to have the first mode shape pattern in x direction, I should select mode number 1 in while making the pushover load case. So let's just now go to the pushover load case after confirming this. Let me click on stop animation. And similarly, if I wanted to have to perform the pushover analysis in the y direction, and if I want to push the building with first mode shape pattern in y direction, I should actually select mode number 3, because second mode, if I click on here, next. The second mode is actually torsional mode. So if I animate it, it is not the first mode in y direction, it is the first torsional mode. So I should actually go to third mode, and that will become the first mode in y direction. So see, this is mode number 2 and it is torsional mode. So if I go to next, mode number 3, that will be, if I start animating it, that will be the fundamental translational mode in y direction. So you can see here that this is the first mode in y direction. You can see that the building is swaying in fundamental mode direction in y. So mode number 3 is actually the first mode in y direction. So if I want to make a load case for y direction pushover in first mode pattern, I should select mode number 3. So I stop animation now, and let me go to define and load cases here. One thing that I should actually open now, the model which is not run, to show you the making of load case, because if I modify this model, it will delete all the analysis results. So I want to show you results also, so I am opening that other model which is not already run. So I will go to define and then load cases, and in the load cases you can see that there are several load cases there that are already available here. Actually I made them already, but let me add a new case. So click on add new case and then let me name it some, maybe pushover, monotonic pushover, or only pushover, mode 1 in x direction. So pushover mode 1 x, this is my name, and I will select the type as nonlinear static. This is the pushover type of load case. Mass source, you can select a different mass source for this pushover analysis. Mass source is something which is defined earlier actually. If I cancel it and directly show you the define mass source, this option is actually telling the program that which what is the source of mass, how to construct the mass matrix, or how to calculate the seismic weight of the building. So if I modify this mass source, I can say see options here. Currently the element self mass is selected, which means whatever is the self mass of the building of all elements, that should be included in the mass matrix. We can also add some specific load patterns by checking this option, and the load can also be converted into mass and then added to mass of the building. For example, we can add 25% of the live load in the seismic weight or mass of the building. So I can click on add here, but you should not add the dead load again here if you have checked already the element self mass, because that will double count the self weight of the building. So we can just keep its name as default, and I click OK. I can, in fact, I should save if I want to add this 25% of the live load. So this model is not run already, so let me just save it. So this is my mass source. This is telling you from where the mass of the building is coming from. So I click OK, and now again go to the same load cases, define load cases, and add a new load case and give it same name, pushover mode 1 x, and its nonlinear static type. The mass source can be the that mass source which we have just created or modified the default value. Now any nonlinear case, any nonlinear loading case can be started either from zero initial conditions, which means the unstressed condition, or it can be started from the end of another nonlinear load case. So we can either start this pushing this building right from the intact condition or at the end of any other load case. So we know already that this is the requirement in pushover analysis, that whenever we start pushing the building, the gravity load should already be placed at that location and that building already. So actually we should start pushing the analysis, start pushing the building at the end of the gravity load case. So if we go for this second option, continue from the state at the end of nonlinear case, and here we have to select that at the end of which nonlinear case we should start pushing the building with this pattern. So in that list, I can select any other nonlinear case, right? So actually I should select the gravity case here, but which means that I have to first make a gravity nonlinear case and then select here in that list. That will appear here if I have already made a gravity nonlinear case. So I go back again, I cancel that and make a gravity nonlinear case. This is my default gravity case, which has some dead load, live load, superimposed dead load, everything. But it is linear static. I used it for the initial design of this building. So now I will add a copy of that case and declare it as nonlinear. And then this will serve as a predecessor of my pushover load case. So I call it gravity-nonlinear. And then I declare its load case type as nonlinear static. And then I start it with zero initial conditions. Right, so my gravity nonlinear will start with zero initial conditions, no previous loading, but my pushover will start with the end of gravity nonlinear. So whatever is the structural condition at the end of gravity load, that condition will be used at the start of the pushover load case, right? And you might guess by now that when we do the cyclic pushover analysis, what we do is that we make each new load case, we started with the end of the previous load case. So each new pushover is starting from the end of previous pushover load case. So if we push a building up to certain level on right hand side, positive push, we make a new load case in the negative push and we start that load case at the end of that positive push. So that's how we run all those cases in series, one after each other, and at the end we get the cyclic pushover analysis. So I declare this gravity load case as nonlinear static and I started with zero initial conditions. I add all the load patterns which are comprising this gravity nonlinear case. It is actually dead with a scale factor of 1 and live with a scale factor of, let's say, 0.25. Modal case, from where the modal values will come, is by default is modal. Only one modal case is by default available unless we make a new one. P delta is the geometric nonlinearity option. We have two options here. Either we account the geometric nonlinearity by using P delta option, or P delta plus large displacement. In most of the civil engineering structures, only P delta is enough. We want to apply full load. If I modify this option, there are several other options. But if I just want to apply full load, which means whatever is the load pattern here, you just apply it completely. If I click on displacement control, it will not apply full load. It will just monitor the displacement, whatever displacement at a particular node which we select here, it will keep on applying load until that displacement is achieved. But for gravity load case, we will not go for this option. We will just select full load, which means apply the complete gravity load step by step in a nonlinear manner. And similarly, the results saved, there are two options here. The results can be saved for final stage only, which means when you push by gravity load or you apply gravity load step by step, you save the results for final stage, for final push only, or at each stage of the pushover analysis. So for actual pushover analysis, we will be selecting this multiple states, but for gravity load nonlinear case, we go for the default option. Similarly, nonlinear parameters, they most of the time they are not required to be changed, but if you want to change, you can change. For example, the maximum steps can be more than 10. Similarly, the iteration convergence tolerance, this is an important parameter. If your analysis is not converging, you can reduce this tolerance and then it can help in convergence of that analysis. So you can click on OK, and now your nonlinear gravity load case is defined. So it is the same loading, but now applied in increments in a nonlinear manner. Now this nonlinear gravity can serve as a predecessor for your pushover load case. First, this will be applied, and at the end of this load case, your pushover load case will start. So now after defining this gravity nonlinear, let me click on add new case, and let me call it as pushover mode 1 X and nonlinear static. And then mass source can be the same default one maybe. So, and now I will be selecting continue from state at the end of nonlinear case. And in that list, now I select the gravity nonlinear. So that's how I ensure that first the gravity nonlinear will run. And at the end of that gravity nonlinear, whatever is the degraded K matrix and whatever is the condition of the structure, that will be used as a starting point for pushover case. Now let me add here, and in the load type, I will not be applying a defined load pattern. I want the program to automatically calculate pattern for me and then apply it. Let's say that I want to apply the first mode load pattern. So I'll select mode here, and here I should give the mode number now. So in the list, there are from 1 to 12 mode are available. So I'll select the mode number 1. Now I know already that mode number 1 is my first mode shape in X direction. So when I'm performing the mode 1 X analysis, I'm selecting mode 1. If I was performing Y direction, I should have selected mode 3 as my first mode in Y direction. So currently it is in X direction, so I click on mode 1, and scale factor can be retained as 1. Scale factor is a multiplier which can be applied to the loading before applying, so we can use it for many purposes, but here it will be just 1. The modal mode shape should come from modal case. That is by default, only one case is defined. And geometric nonlinearity, P delta, you can select. Load application, you can modify, and you can now declare it as displacement control. See, now you have not selected a certain load pattern here, which can be completely applied. You have to now perform a displacement control pushover case. So click on displacement control, which means the program will keep on tracking the target displacement until it reach your particular given value and keep on pushing up to that value. So displacement control option will be selected, and now you can go for this monitored displacement. That is an easier option. Give the value of monitored displacement here, and give the node value and degree of freedom in which you want to monitor this displacement. So let me again click on OK, and let me click OK, and I'll come back to it because I want to see what is node number of my roof and what is the degree of freedom number, for example. So this pushover mode 1 X is already there, but it's not complete. I'll come back to it. Let me click OK. Now let's say that I want to select the roof value, roof node, as my control node. So, and I have assigned the rigid diaphragm to my roof. So let me slightly rotate it like this. Let's say that this is my roof level. This is my roof level. And I have already defined the rigid diaphragm to this roof level, which means that this whole diaphragm is going to translate together. There will be no internal stretching or internal compression, relative movement between any of the two nodes located in this diaphragm. So which means that all of those nodes which are selected now, if I just show you by rotating, all of those nodes which are selected at the roof level, they will translate in X direction together or in Y direction together, because I have assigned the rigid diaphragm option for this level. So which means that any of the roof node can be used as a control node, because they are going to translate together, right? So let me first select any of the node. Maybe let me go to the roof plan view. So this is my story 10, which is, I think, this is not the complete roof. So let me go one level down. Yeah, this is my roof level, and any of the node in this roof level can be selected as the control node, and that should be declared or given in the pushover load case. So let me click on clear, and let me select this particular node, which is the node of this shear wall, core wall actually, as the control node. So the program will monitor this, the displacement in X direction of this particular node, and whenever the displacement reach to our given value, the program will terminate the pushover case and will report the pushover curve. So let me right click on this particular node. So here I actually have noted down that its name is, its unique name is 289. Its label is 25. So this node, I should note down this information. Story 9, label 25 and unique name 289. So let me just give these information to my load case in pushover analysis. So I go to load case and modify the same pushover mode 1x, click on modify show, and in the load application I modify that. And I select story 9, and degree of freedom is U1. U1 is in X direction, U2 is in Y direction. So I want to push it in X1 direction. So I give its, the direction is U1. Now this is the joint information, and that is actually, it was 25. So story 9, joint 25, and this number is my monitored displacement. This is the level of displacement up till which I want to push my building. So let's say that I give it as 50 inches. So you can just push it up to a roof drift of maybe 5% or 6%, very high number first, and the program will keep on pushing the building up to that level. And the results will be saved for each increment of the push. And when you calculate the target displacement from any of those methods, which I will discuss, or I'm not sure I'll be having time to discuss, but I'll show you those methods. And then you can come back to pushover results and extract all the responses at that target displacement. So currently you can give any high number, maybe 5 or 6% roof drift, just to plot the complete pushover curve, and then later you can extract results at your desired target displacement. So I give 50 inches to this particular node and I click OK, and this is now modified. The result saved, you can modify show, and then you can click on this multiple states, because you want the results to be saved at each pushover step. So click on multiple stage and click OK. Nonlinear parameters you can modify show, and the default number of total steps is 200, which means the program will keep on pushing your building in 200 increments until your control node's displacement approach 50 inches. And that control node you have already given, that is at story 9. And similarly, this is your iteration convergence tolerance. Let's keep it this way. If our analysis is not converged, then we can reduce this number. So I can click on OK. And this will conclude my definition of pushover load case. If I want to push my building in first mode pattern in X direction, and if I want to have a gravity nonlinear as a predecessor to my pushover load case. So I click on OK, and my pushover mode 1x is defined already. Similarly, I can copy this case again, and I can define for y direction also, keeping all these things same. So this can be now, the name can be y, and obviously the mode number will be changed now because the third mode was the first mode in y direction. So I have modified the mode number to 3. Push over mode 1 in y direction is actually mode 3. So one more thing will be changed, and that is this load application. Let's say the target displacement, or the displacement up till which I want to push the building, is same as 50 inches. But now the same control node will be pushed, but the monitored displacement will be in the y direction. So I should select U2 here so that the program will ensure that the push is continued until U2 degree of freedom in this particular node or joint at this story reaches 50 inches. So I click OK, and I click again OK. So this will be my mode 1 in Y direction pushover case, right? So now I can quickly run them. I can go to analyze and set load cases to run. And now I can simply run these last two pushover results.